Jerry. Thank you. Thanks, Jerry, for that very warm introduction, and thanks to everyone for coming on this even warmer evening. It's a nice dash of warm weather early. It's a pleasure to be invited to deliver this lecture in memory of Anne Hawke, the Foundation Director of the Centre for Applied Economics, from which my centre emerged. Anne was a fine applied microeconomist, and we've changed direction into regulation and what markets do, but still microeconomics is microeconomics, and it's nice to be talking in this series tonight. First up, I must make a disclaimer. What I say tonight should be attributed to no one but me, and certainly not to any of the regulatory appeal bodies on which I sit. When Jerry asked me to give tonight's lecture, it struck me that pro vice chancellors and regulators have many things in common. They have to deal with a very argumentative set of stakeholders. They're always asking them for more information, and they always think they're right. But in the eyes of many of the stakeholders, they often come up with the wrong answer. Now, obviously, both regulators and pro vice chancellors stray off the beaten track from time to time because, after all, to err is human. But pretty much they get it right most of the time. A balanced view, I'd think, would say, on average, regulators and PVCs do a good job. So I think everyone agrees they're a necessary evil. Now, we just have to make sure that the principles that guide them, regulators and pro vice chancellors, and their operational processes are appropriate for the task at hand, and that the decisions, if thought to be wrong, can be appealed. But pretty much it's easier to appeal a regulator's decision than it is a pro vice chancellor's. Anyhow, now, regulation is a hot topic now, certainly since the GFC. Now, why is that? Well, our markets, both micro markets, individual markets, and macro markets, international markets, are becoming much more complex. Their operations and linkages are becoming truly international, and more countries, firms, individuals, consumers are being drawn into their embrace. And so regulation has become much more complicated. Much more complex in terms of the facts it has to deal with, the institutional arrangements, the analyses that have to be done, and of course the ultimate impact that regulation has. So we need to think about, why do we need regulation? What's the best regulation? Why has regulation made mistakes? And what can we do about it? And I hope to cover, or just touch really, because it's a huge area, these questions tonight. Emphasise that my experience is as a micro regulator. I'm not a macro economist, and I've never regulated interest rates or financial crises or anything like that. But the principle of regulation remains, or the principles of regulation remain the same in both small markets, in sectors, and in international markets. So the theory pretty much covers everything. Given my background, it shouldn't come as any surprise to you that I believe in regulation. As Jerry said, I've been a regulator for about 25 years in areas of competition, employment services, and telecommunications. But I think I can say without any fear of contradiction that wrong decisions are made from time to time by regulators. I probably also have made an occasional wrong decision somewhere in my career as a regulator. So I'm not saying regulation or regulators are perfect, far from it, but regulatory failure usually has a good reason for it. Regulators make mistakes, not necessarily because of their own fault, but because of the environment in which they work. And a lot of reasons for that, and I'll touch on some of those tonight. But it's an uncomfortable fact of life for most regulators that there are some people in important places that think regulation necessarily gets it wrong and that free markets will always get it right. So these people say best policy is hands off and free markets. Now, these people, and there's some quite respectable economists and lawyers and others amongst them, also believe that markets are perfectly informed, that buyers and sellers are equally matched in markets, that there are no real barriers to entry into markets, and quite likely they also believe that the Crows will win the AFL Grand Final next year. They believe that if the market gets out of balance, if collusion or market power emerges, then market forces will simply emerge to fix the situation. Well, markets might be self-correcting in the long run. Certainly, forces will emerge to get rid of most of the imperfections in markets, but meanwhile, very serious damage might happen to consumers, to other firms in the market, and it might take a long time to fix it. And remember, as John Maynard Keynes once said, in the long run, we're all dead. Now, you mightn't think that Winston Churchill and Dan Quayle would have had much in common, but they did. Churchill once said, if you have 10,000 regulations, you destroy all respect for the law. And Quayle once said, I do have a political agenda. It's unusual, but he said he did. It's to have as few regulations as possible. Now, I beg to differ. Regulation is not a curse. I think it's a cure, or at least an antidote, to the problem of market failure, which we observe everywhere around us. So to ensure that markets work in the public interest, a guiding hand is needed. Not the guiding hand that Adam Smith talked about, because he really didn't have much faith in the ability of entrepreneurs to do the right thing. Remember his quote, people of the same trade seldom meet together, even for merriment and diversion, but that the conversation ends in a conspiracy against the public. Rather, we need a regulation to keep markets on the straight and narrow. Not necessarily an iron fist, but a velvet glove that occasionally puts the iron fist into it and makes firms realise that they're not performing to their social optimum. Regulators need to do this, and they need to understand how their market is operating. Now, this, of course, assumes that government has set up the regulatory infrastructure correctly to start with. That might be a heroic assumption, because regulators can really only work with their or within their legislative remit. Sort of legislation I advocate is what we can call light-handed regulation, not constant interference. We don't want that. We want the regulator to be there just to nudge the market into good ways rather than bad ways. You might have seen the new chair of the ACCC, Rod Sims, 2 or 3 weeks ago after he was appointed, saying he'd be aggressive in bringing cases to court and I want to test the limits of my regulatory powers, especially with respect to Woolworths, Coles, the airports and the NBN. Now, this alarmed business. One prominent businessman said there's a real danger in, quote, regulating the hell out of certain areas, and noted that this sort of activity by the ACCC would significantly raise business costs and affect their reputation. Very prominent corporate mergers and acquisitions lawyer Dave Potter from Allen & Overy cautioned it would be better for the ACCC simply to telegraph how it will interpret the law so that businesses can adjust their behaviour to fit within the law. So you'll always get a burst of regulatory zeal when new chairs come into regulatory positions, and so we can expect some quite vigorous, I suspect, behaviour from the ACCC in the next few months. Now, if you're wondering what regulation really should do, I often say you should think about regulation as a bit like what happens on a horse racing track. The rails are there to keep the horses running properly. You know, so long as you run within the rails, then it's okay. And that's what legislation aims to do. It sets up the parameters within which you can operate. Once, though, a horse starts to misbehave, cuts across another, or a jockey does something that's perhaps a bit naughty, then we need the stewards to rein them in, at least after the race is over. What we want to make sure is that the horse wins on its own merits, or luck, as sometimes happens. The race stewards have the job only of making sure that the fair rivalry they expect on a race course happens, and that's a regulator's job. To make sure that rivals act fairly, that they don't play dirty. Gold Souk in Dubai is a good example of this. The market police, and they're there, check for quality and that there's no misrepresentation of the product. why they do this is to protect the consumer. They want consumers, especially tourists, to go back there again and think that it's a good place and that you won't be taken advantage of. They want to keep the reputation of the whole souk in good standing. Of course, with respect to the final price that we pay, that's entirely a matter of caveat emptor and the customer's good bargaining skills. So they're not there to make sure you get the lowest price, but they're there to make sure that the quality is good and that there's no misrepresentation by the stallholders in the souk. So regulation, broadly speaking, should be a bit like Goldilocks porridge. Not too hot, not too cold, not too intrusive, not too laid back, just right. Bad regulation is perhaps worse than no regulation at all, because it can impose significant costs on society which will be hard to retrieve. Now the GFC certainly showed us what can happen when regulation is misguided or not tuned finely enough. It demonstrated how poor the regulation of financial markets had been for some time, and how that regulation failed to cope with the increasing innovation and sophistication of financial instruments and markets. It also showed that when times get tough, the deniers come out in force to say competition regulation is bad, we shouldn't have it, let's get rid of it. Now, I think that's something that we have learned from the GFC, that regulation needs to be changed and that competition still plays a very important role in regulation in any market. However, what's the right level of intervention? There's no such thing as the correct level of intervention, because there's not just economic reasons for regulation, but there's social and political as well. And it's impossible to regulate out all bad conduct. You just couldn't do it, because the cost of getting rid of the last little bit of bad conduct would far outweigh the benefits to society of doing that. So you have to accept that regulation will always leave some poor behaviour unchecked. It's simply not feasible to get rid of it all. Now, this means that regulator agencies have to make choices. They don't have unlimited funding. They don't have unlimited staff. They have to decide what they think is best in the interest of society in terms of their regulation. Now, regulation is expensive, and they simply don't have a bottomless purse to pursue everything that comes in the door. Now, it means the ACCC and other regulatory bodies have to make choices and prioritise their inquiries unless their budget is plumped up. And of course, we see when the GST was introduced that the ACCC was given quite a big extra allocation of funds to make sure people weren't taking advantage of the GST by raising their prices more than they should have. And of course, if the carbon tax ever does come in, it's been said that the ACCC will have the job of making sure that people aren't overcharged because of that, and no doubt the government will give them money for that if the current government is still there. Now, as markets evolve, regulators have to keep up with the markets and what's happening, and they often have to develop new paradigms to deal with the market. A good example of this is e-commerce and search engines in particular. The emerging technology is changing almost daily. Now, how can we best use and understand the flood of information that's now available to us online? How can service providers best supply it to us? Should we be concerned about the apparent market power of Google? Some say, what market power? Especially supporters of Google, and there's a whole bunch of economists who have paid a lot of money to say Google does not have market power. Now, if Google is misusing its market power, what can we do about it? How can we stop them doing it? How can we stop them ranking allegedly their own products first in search pages and so on? There are enormous challenges here for regulators as markets evolve, as technology changes, and they have to catch up with it and try and be ahead of the market rather than behind the market. If they're behind the market, they'll make mistakes and firms will get away with behaviour that's not all that desirable. So regulating for competition is inherently controversial. It's an unfortunate truth that there's no one right answer in almost every regulatory situation. Now, what is a competitive market? I couldn't tell you if you put a gun to my head. I couldn't give you a definition that would satisfy everyone. Or what's the right rate of return that a state regulator should allow a utility company to charge you and I for gas or electricity? Now, consumers will say one thing, governments will say another thing, and of course the shareholders of the regulated firm would want a higher price to be allowed. But these are the outcomes that regulators are tasked with achieving, and it's certainly not easy for them to strike the right balance. Now, regulation then is a balancing act, it's a juggling act. And if you ever tried to juggle yourself, you'll know it's not easy. And even if you're a good juggler, you can, you know, drop the ball every now and then. If you try to balance on a plank, sometimes it's not all that easy either. So there's lots of room for discretion to be exercised by regulators. And it's an inescapable fact of life that most regulators are economists. Now, some are lawyers, so we should share the blame around a bit for so-called regulatory errors, but predominantly they're economists. And we know that economics is not an exact science, and we know that economists don't have a good record for their predictive powers, and we know that economists go around saying on the one hand this and on the other hand that. Now, because the discipline of economics is inextricably interwoven into the regulatory process, then it means that usually there are diametrically opposed debates between regulators and the firms that they're regulating. Now, some people would have you believe regulators get it wrong all the time. They don't. So who do we blame? Not the economists, it's not their fault. Yes, regulators do make mistakes, but so do judges. Judges get appealed, not all that infrequently. Engineers design things that fall down. Surgeons make mistakes. Architects design eyesores. I've probably offended a lot of people in the audience now. Every professional group makes mistakes. So there has to be appeal authorities, so that if mistake is made, then it can be appealed to a higher body. About the only regulators that you can't appeal are AFL umpires. If they make a mistake, there's not much that can be done about it, even if it's a grand final with 30 seconds to go. So where do you draw the line between good hard commercial rivalry, which a regulator, a competition regulator, has to look at, and what you might call dirty tricks? It's not easy. Where do you draw the line between what's a fair commercial rate of return for a regulated firm and a price that's fair to consumers? There's no ambiguous answer. Talk to any regulator and they'll tell you about Gilbert and Sullivan that a regulator's job is not a happy one. Regulators have to present what they think is harmful to social welfare in the context of the law within which they're operating. So several questions come to mind here. Should firms be more cooperative with regulators? Should they not be as antagonistic? The answer is yes, they should, but it rarely happens. How do you convince regulators that they might be getting it wrong? Well, there are a series of procedures that can be used. I'll talk about them in just a minute. And if we do need regulation, and regulators can go astray from time to time, who regulates the regulators? Okay, you can set up a watchdog, and that's been done, a watchdog to oversee what a regulator does. Sometimes governments, when they appoint a new chair of a regulator body, install on the board someone from the government department to make sure that the person at the top goes down the straight and narrow path. I've seen that happen. Senate estimates committees in Australia are good for keeping regulators on their toes. Now, while the various members of the various senators don't know much regulation at all, they can still bring hard-nosed regulators to a tremble. The questions that are put to them, believe me, I've seen that. You have appeal bodies, obviously, judicial and quasi-judicial. You can have consultative committees. Many regulatory agencies have external consultative committees. You can have internal or external ex post review, like the Productivity Commission sometimes does, about the impact of regulation in Australia. The press certainly serves as a ginger group for regulators. Public opinion. You can change the chair. That makes it a bit political. Hasn't really happened in Australia. You can provide for specific government direction to a regulator. In New Zealand, the competition regulator, the Competition Commission, can be directed by the government to do certain things. Now, I'm not suggesting that regulators make errors systematically or deliberately, but we always need to keep in mind that there is the potential for regulatory capture, where the regulator becomes beholden to the industry that it's regulating. Plenty of evidence of this in the United States, none that I'm really aware of in Australia. Now, why do regulators get it wrong? Well, they can be given misleading information. It's in the firm's interest not to give them the right information, to try and snow the regulator with a nice rosy picture as to how well the firm is behaving. And it is hard to make good discretionary decisions, and that's what a regulator has to do, it's got discretion, to make good decisions in the absence of full information. The legislation that a regulator has to work with may have been not very precise or may be getting out of date. Now, the Competition Tribunal last year, in coming to a decision on the railway access issues in the northern, in West Australia, made some comments about Part 3A, the access provisions of the Trade Practices Act, as it was then, was badly out of date. Now, whether the government acts on that, of course, is another issue. Should declare an interest here, I was part of that tribunal that said that. It's sometimes the regulator's interpretation of the law that's out of line. Sometimes a regulatory philosophy of the regulator's own choosing can creep into its assessment. And that's not what we want. Not a good thing at all. Now, administrators and bureaucrats, as I've just said, don't always get it right. If you want any illustration of that, just ask the Metcash directors about the ACCC's decision to stop them buying the Franklin supermarket chain from Pick and Pay. Now, it's now under appeal to the full federal court. Or the disagreement that erupted last week between the Productivity Commission and the ACCC over whether airports should be more strongly regulated or not. ACCC says, we've been too light-handed, we really need to have stronger powers. Productivity Commission says, well, no, just ask them to show cause why they shouldn't be investigated. So quite a clash there, and the Financial Review in its editorial last week, it's very tiny to read in this light, said that the ACCC and the Productivity Commission normally sing from the same hymn book, if perhaps not the same hymn, when it comes to competition form. And that's true, but saying now there appears to be a real difference in what they think about airports, and that's something that's going to have to be resolved. Okay, another reason why regulators sometimes get it wrong is that they have strict statutory time limits, and sometimes you just can't do the amount of investigation that you'd like to do in the time that's available for you to investigate. Now, if regulators make mistakes, it's a basic tenet then of fairness and accountability that their decision should be appealable. This can be either in the form of a judicial review, regulator got the law wrong, or a de novo or on the papers merits review, where it will be asked whether the decision of the regulator was either unreasonable given the circumstances, or that the regulator used its discretion incorrectly, or that it made errors of fact. Now, regulators can do all of those three things, there's no doubt about that. Sometimes they have to work retrospectively to prosecute a firm for what it's thought that they did, price fixing, misuse of market power, or whatever. And the aim of that is really to deter future examples of this sort of behaviour which are thought to be socially bad. Other times regulators have to work proactively. For example, the Metcash Franklin's merger, because you want to try and affect market structure in the future so that it won't be likely to lead to any competitive behaviour. Regulators, in looking at what rate of return, the weighted average cost of capital, the WACC, to give to a regulated entity, have a lot of things to consider. Cost of debt, cost of equity, market risk premium, deck risk premium, and so on. And there's simply no one right answer there. And you'll find the parties on appeal arguing from quite different perspectives for quite divergent values. All right, once a regulator decides to intervene, how does it do it? There's a variety of ways. You can go and jawbone, as they say in the trade, the offending parties and try and get them to stop what they're doing. Or you can try and get them to amend their behaviour a little bit. Or if they're really recalcitrant, you'll say, OK, I'll see you in court. And there are many ways of killing a cat, as they say, and the sorts of penalties which a regulator can impose range from the equivalent of the electric chair, and that's divestiture of a merger that goes ahead without you saying it was okay, all the way through to a slap on the wrist with a feather duster, which is a mild warning from the ACCC. And we've seen all of that range of outcomes occurring in Australia. Now, because there's no bright line as to what's right and what's wrong, with the exception of smoking gun offences, as we call them, if firms are caught fixing prices in a smoke-filled room, then there's not much they can do about it. But that's rare in competition regulation. There's usually no right answer. And you have to get market evidence. Market evidence is hard to get. And especially in the early stage of a new law or early stage of new enforcement, like what Rod Sims is suggesting the ACCC will do now, errors can be expected. You just don't have enough information, you don't have enough background in the area, and you'll make errors. Now, you'd hope, though, that in the long run, talking about the long run again, regulators would learn from their mistakes. Do they? Pretty much so, I think, but you know, regulators are very much a function, or regulator action rather, is very much a function of the chair. A new chair comes in, new chair has different ideas, molds the staff in different ways, and has different priorities that he or she thinks are the thing that they really should be spending their time on. And of course, not only will they possibly make decision errors, but regulatory theories change over time as well. And so you're constantly dealing with experts and arguments from lawyers that say, well, this is the paradigm you should really be looking at now. This is a new paradigm. Everyone accepts this paradigm. Academics have developed it. It's been endorsed by governments in this country and that country. So you have to come up to date and up to speed with new paradigms, new regulatory paradigms as well. Some errors can be fairly cheaply fixed. If the ACCC knocks back a merger, then it's up to the companies to go back and rejig it, come up with something that might satisfy the Commission, selling off a few supermarkets in West Australia or selling off 10 in Victoria or something like that. Now, time is lost. And it does mean that another suitor can perhaps come in and steal the target away from the original bidder's nose. Or you can go to the regulator later on and say, look, market conditions have changed. This certainly happened back in 2005-06 when Qantas and Air New Zealand sought to have an alliance. The ACCC said no. And then it came to the tribunal on appeal, another interest to declare, I said, on this tribunal. And we said, yes, they can go ahead with the merger. It is not anti-competitive. But that was 18 months later. The facts had changed quite a bit. In particular, Emirates had entered the Trans-Tasman market, and so had Virgin. And there was a lot of excess capacity. They were cutting prices way, way, way below where they were before. And we thought that that would have been plenty of competition to keep a Qantas Air New Zealand alliance in line. Well, in New Zealand, the Commerce Commission said no, and it was appealed there as well to the New Zealand High Court. But in New Zealand, a High Court appeal is based on the original facts. So even though they were 2 years out of date, the New Zealand High Court found that there'd been no error by the Commerce Commission, so it didn't go ahead. But we do have to be careful. If you approve a merger when you don't really know what's coming up, if your crystal ball's not been polished all that well, then there mightn't be much that can be done later to get the market back to its original state of competition. As we like to say, once the eggs have been scrambled, you can't easily unscramble them. Okay, now that's sort of the stuff I do. Now let's turn to the GFC. And the role of competition in that, and the bad role that regulation played generally throughout the GFC. It's a fact of history that in times of unexpected crisis, We often see calls for regulation to be suspended or weakened to help kickstart the market back into health. Generally speaking, in the face of depressed conditions, failing firm claims grow like wildflowers in the desert after spring rains. High unemployment can lead to claims for certain favours for certain areas of labour. What people are looking for usually is an easy fix, external life support system, rather than becoming more adept at adapting to the challenges of the market. There's also the siren song for governments of helping out supposed national champions or employment generating firms in certain seats, and let's not put too fine a point of it, they're usually marginal electoral seats. And that's a strong one for government. So governments will often urge regulators to go easy in times of financial crisis. What regulators need to do is stand up to the government and say, are they really failing? Can they fix themselves? Is this a short run or a long run problem? If they're long run failures, then let's get rid of them now. Let's be cruel to be kind rather than just propping them up for another year or two. Now, of course, in some markets, wholesale market failure would be a disaster, as in the case of banking. And so you might need specifically targeted policy solutions there. But in any financial crisis, politics usually rears its ugly head, and macro financial stability will usually take precedence over competition and other forms of social regulation. But generally speaking, my point is industrial policy and competition policy don't make good and certainly not efficient bedfellows, and we need to be very wary of that. Thurman Arnold, who was the head of the United States Department of Justice in 1940, wrote in his book, The Bottlenecks of Business, that the antitrust laws must constantly defend the ideal of industrial democracy against all sorts of pressures. Now, how true that is. Whenever economies sink towards recession, this guiding principle was conveniently forgotten as everyone jockeys to get support to favour their own case. And usually policymakers are urged to cast common sense to the winds and just prop up these failing firms and failing industries. Now, the problem is, in depressed conditions, the cost of regulatory error can be really, really high. Because if you prop up a firm now, when it's likely to be failing forever, they're irretrievable costs that you're imposing on society. Let it go. In fact, many would say competition policy should take a stronger stand in times like the GFC to get the long-run benefits which competitive markets will provide. But it's all a matter of balance, as I said before. It's a juggling act and it's hard to get it right. Now, we should learn from the mistakes of the past in dealing with economic crises, financial crises, especially international ones. It's generally agreed, and I'm sure the economics historians in the audience here tonight, and I've seen a couple of them, it's now generally agreed that lax or non-existent antitrust enforcement during the Great Depression in the United States prolonged the downturn of the Great Crash by suspending the operation of the antitrust laws and allowing cartels to operate. President Hoover actually urged firms to curb their, quote, wasteful competitive excesses by exchanging data and ideas through trade associations. So there's a naked presidential plea to firms to collude. Really amazing. You wouldn't see that these days, but certainly it happened back in the time of the Great Depression. President Roosevelt also temporarily suspended the antitrust laws in 1933, misguidedly thinking that by letting firms do whatever they wanted to, it would speed recovery from the Depression. Well, what the result of that was, of course, that the firms promptly engaged in considerable monopoly-type conduct that previously was illegal and they couldn't get away with, and it retarded for many years the return to normal market trading conditions. It's rare indeed for the dead hand of government to do better than the guiding hand of the market, but the guiding hand of the market has to be carefully aided by careful regulatory oversight, is the message I want to get through tonight. Okay, now competition policy needs to be flexible. It must be flexible. It must be able to take account of the environment and general questions of financial stability. There's no doubt about that. And of course it needs to show some signs of social compassion from time to time. But it's likely, my argument is, to be inefficient to engineer the survival of struggling firms and to prop markets up when there's really no chance that they'll survive to properly handle the varying market forces of supply and demand. Now, we do, though, need to be mindful of the need to distinguish between firms and industries that face long-run structural problems. My argument is we should really ease them out. And those that are experiencing a short-run cyclical decline due to no fault of their own. They're the ones that need the support, not the long-term mistakes that really we would be best off without. Okay, now, while there's no one single recipe for success, the GFC certainly raised expectations that there could be. Everyone was looking for the one single solution to get us out of the financial mess that we saw ourselves in just a few short years ago. And we got a lot of special interest demands and short-sighted and often self-serving remedies being demanded that flew in the face of long-run economic efficiency and that might well, in some cases, become long-run structural problems for us to deal with. Now, the real problem was that in the GFC, it wasn't caused by poor competition policy or enforcement to start with, far from it. It wasn't caused by too much competition either. It was the result of macro imbalances, I think, and a financial system regulatory structure that lagged badly behind market innovation. It was also caused by untrammeled greed and asymmetrical incentives in the financial sector that led executives to be well rewarded for successes, but no penalty at all if they failed. In the 1980s, the Hong Kong colonial government's pithy finance secretary, John Bembridge, noted that when it came to regulation, the Hong Kong stock market stood, quote, somewhere between a swamp and the inside of a Swedish dairy. Probably very true. Now, it was suggested by a Financial Review reporter only a couple of weeks ago that that attitude represented a nod and a wink to a robust pragmatism common in the region at the time that put successful business outcomes ahead of nitpicking rules. Well, it's not really polite to say that sort of thing these days, and certainly Hong Kong now sends a much different message. Its regulatory system has been called a squeaky clean haven for investors and listings from the real swamp next door. And of course, the real swamp next door refers to China's stock markets and the shady conduct and scandals that are often observed therein, right from the top. There's top-down problems with bureaucracy and insider training, leaked information, and so on. Now, that's the sort of thing that really led to the GFC. A lot of shady trading and insufficient regulatory checks. Now, many portray the GFC as what's called a black swan, a 100-year event, something that doesn't occur very often. Of course, if you're trading, no black swans are pretty common, so it's not really all that rare. But we have short memories. The GFC was simply the most recent occurrence of a recurrent, if not systematic, pattern of financial hubris and excesses and subsequent bailout from the public purse. History is littered with sagas of cheap and easy credit, radically new financial instruments, snake oil salespeople, excessive optimism that all together lead to price bubbles and the inevitable crashes. Just for example, tulip prices in the 17th century, the South Sea bubble in 1720, banking panics in America in the 1830s and in 1907, the Great Crash, the 1982 three crisis, where reckless lending to Latin American countries led to a severe debt crisis for many banks and a few countries in real trouble, including Mexico and Brazil. And of course, don't forget the US savings and loan debacles of the late 80s and the early 90s. So everything old is new again, as the Peter Allen, Chris Bayer, Sayer song says. But one thing's for sure, we simply haven't learned from our mistakes. Economists have been highly critical of what went on. Joe Stiglitz argued that the incentive structure encouraged excessive risk-taking and a focus on short-run outcomes. He writes that to understand risk, you have to know a little bit of mathematics, and in many of the banks, the people on top are lawyers who have never taken a course in advanced statistics. It's inevitable that they'll make mistakes, and financial systems always behave badly, so it shouldn't have been a surprise. So why weren't we prepared? Why weren't we ready to regulate what turned out to be the GFC? Well, the problem was no single regulator had the power to regulate the whole system, either within a country or between countries. No single regulator had the power to demand information on all of the aspects of the GFC that was unfolding before them. No single regulator had the power or perhaps the wish to resolve and deal with the regulatory arbitrage or forum shopping that various firms are doing. If you don't look after us, or if you give us too hard a deal in this market, we'll go and list in another country, that sort of thing. Now, some have argued that regulators had the power but were caught napping. I think it's probably a combination of both. Generally, we saw a plethora of panic-driven government programs produced at the drop of a hat almost in all the major economies designed to stem the flow of damage and to prop up the banks and the other financial institutions whose own greed and ineptitude and the perverse incentives facing their executives contributed heavily to the problem. What economists call moral hazard, and of course bailout became the new buzzword. But there was no real argument on what was the best response. People will agree though that the GFC provided a test of both regulatory practices and regulatory architectures, and they both failed miserably in just about every economy, perhaps with two major exceptions which I'll mention in just a minute. General consensus that no single factor caused the GFC, but there's probably consensus that five or six factors did and that regulators were unable to control. Someone's called one the adrenaline-fueled adventures under the guise of financial innovation. True. Derivatives, hedge funds, all of these. Securitisation brought into the market a massive influx of new and largely misunderstood financial instruments. Regulators weren't prepared for that. There was a massive deterioration in lending standards and a deterioration in credit rating standards, and the credit rating bodies were pretty much forced to give good credit ratings because the firms that are asking them to rate them said, well, if you don't do it for us, we'll go somewhere else. And so they tended to capitulate and gave credit ratings that really were quite misleading. There was a growth in what's called the shadow banking sector. Hedge funds and the like, which had never been regulated before. There was an inability to assess the risk positions of many borrowers. Banks just wanted to lend, and they were encouraged to lend. Each bank only looked at the risks and the consequences to itself, and not at the systemic outcomes of them all lending. And they pretty much knew that they were going to be bailed out if anything went wrong. As a result of all of this, then governments are exposed and regulators are exposed. Poor government policies, poor regulatory policies, a complete absence of reliable public information as to what was going on in these markets, no early warning systems that might have helped things a bit, and what I think you can call benign, ranging to incompetent neglect by the various macro regulators. Now, we need a new paradigm. What can we do to stop that again? Well, we need to have international cooperation. We need to have a carefully systematic think through as to what it is in macro markets that caused the problem and how we might fix it. We've got to make sure that there's no revolving doors between regulators and the very industries that they are regulating. Regulators were being teased into appeasing demands for stability and certain favours in order to preserve their long-run autonomy, prestige and job prospects. Not a good recipe for regulatory success. Now, fortunately in Australia, we didn't get much more than the economic equivalent of a runny nose from the GFC, which was fixed by the financial equivalent of a couple of aspirins and a bit of a lie down. With this partly by luck, just happened to be in the right place at the right time, partly by the fact that we hadn't given in to the financial excesses so evident elsewhere, and as some would have it, thanks also to the efforts, even if by default, of the latest addition to the ranks of the world's greatest treasurers, if indeed there is room for more than one Australian eminence in that beauty parade. Now, in part, our regulatory structures were in good shape, largely thanks to a series of public inquiries into the financial system and the ensuing regulatory reform by a succession of Liberal and Labor governments. That's one thing they have pretty much had in common, to get a good financial system operating and regulated sensibly over the years. It's also possibly due to the fact that we had one overriding and vigorously intrusive and certainly effective financial system regulator, the Australian Prudential Regulatory Authority. And Jeff Carmichael, the inaugural chair of APRA, wrote a few months ago in an ex-post review of the GFC that the two standout countries to emerge from the GFC were Australia and Canada. He noted that both countries had developed financial systems that were fully integrated into the global financial system, yet both sailed through the GFC storm, he said, with relative ease. Now, why was that? Well, he said that these two countries had the toughest regulators, toughest financial system regulators in the world in terms of regulatory standards and supervisory oversight. And as he said, each one is distinguished by having only one prudential regulator that regulates banks and all of the other financial organisations in the markets. So they knew what was going on. In other words, in all of their financial markets, nothing was much of a surprise to them when the GFC hit. Now, of course, other countries had much more mixed experiences. The European countries suffered directly, as did the United States. Most Asian countries suffered relatively less, for good reasons. Their financial systems had much lower levels of integration into the global financial markets, and because they had a much lower appetite for the risky new forms of financial innovation. So the message here is that greed is dangerous. When financial markets are consumed by greed, things go wrong. But we shouldn't rest too heavily on our laurels here in Australia about that good report card. The Financial Stability Board Subcommittee of the G20 recently warned that our big four banks are now posing systemic and moral hazard risks that need policy and regulatory action because of the structural changes arising from their vast exposure to Australia's mining boom and the record high terms of trade. So if we're facing increased exposure to volatile and cyclical commodity prices, then the argument is we really do need to develop some further prudential tools to manage the sector-specific risks arising from these structural changes. So we can't drop our regulatory guard. We've got a good track record so far in Australia. We need to make sure that that continues. We don't want our banks to fail. I doubt whether anyone's even contemplated that. But we need to develop a progressive and what you might call a graduated supervisory response. Too much regulatory change too quickly is a recipe for disaster. Remember what Dave Potter said about the new ACCC's chair about intervening more vigorously straight away. Too much regulatory change too quickly simply creates massive uncertainty. No business works well in such conditions of uncertainty. So the GFC has taught us that we need much smarter regulation, especially in the presence of financial innovation. That's going to continue. We need simply to regulate smarter. Now, we might need to make sure that regulators need to be independent, government, bold, and beholden to no one. But above all, we need effective supranational regulatory and supervisory schemes to stop regulatory arbitrage or forum shopping, as I've called it. Because financial markets now are truly international. And so regulators, while they have their own sovereign responsibilities, really do need to talk to the guys next door or in the next country or in the next continent. But as I've been saying, there's no right answer. Regulators, have to remember, are really risk managers. They're just managing risk. Whether it be macro regulators or whether it be the air safety regulators in Australia, they thought they were managing risk when they banned Tiger from flying a few months ago. There were serious risks, they said, to the public, to the travelling public, and so Tiger was suspended until they could convince the Civil Aviation Authority that their planes were properly maintained and pilots trained, etc., etc. So regulators need to protect the public from this financial contagion. They need to know how to handle risks when they come out of the blue. And the question is, do they lead with risk management or do they respond? I think they need to try and lead, but inevitably, of course, there's that once in a lifetime event that you weren't ready for, but they then have to be flexible enough to deal with that. Okay, I've just been given the 5 minute sign, so. Okay, regulatory change always should be evaluated in terms of expected social benefits and the expected social costs over the long run. You can't afford to just have a knee-jerk reaction to the flavour of the day, either economic, political or social. You need to find the right regulatory system. It may need experimentation. You may make mistakes from time to time, but it's better to be prepared through trial and error rather than going in with a policy which is completely wrong. What the GFC told us is that light-handed regulation is not a good thing. We need to perhaps be ready to step in and be a bit harder in a macro sense. It might be more important in macro markets, international markets, to regulate more heavily than it would be to regulate, say, the market for soft drinks or the market for airline travel within Australia. Okay, we must be conscious all the time of protecting investors and consumers. They tend to get forgotten in all of this, but ultimately regulators are there to advance social welfare, to protect investors, to protect consumers. And we want to make sure that regulatory rules are subversion proof, that firms can't find ways to get around them. Now, one lesson from the GFC is that countries that focused on principles generally fared better than those that focused on rules. So principles are important, and then clued up regulators who can interpret those principles rather than following arbitrary rules to the letter. So while the regulatory architecture, as they call it, must be sound, ultimately it's the case that effective regulation demands sound practice and vigorous enforcement. Flexibility is the key word here, but flexibility that is predictable and flexibility that is sensible. Now, just to wrap up, if you live in a bushfire-prone area, it's not much good clearing your undergrowth if your neighbour doesn't. We all know that. It's the same with financial market regulation, given the massive degrees of interdependence that I've mentioned tonight. Everyone must be subject to regulatory control under a unified will, so that you're all singing the same hymn, to put it in the words of the AFR regulator. Local councils enforce undergrowth clearing, so companies should work together for international macro stability. So effective global financial market regulation is what economists call a pure public good. Won't be supplied at all or be undersupplied if you leave it to the market. We need to be proactive, not reactive, in formulating new policies. We need to coordinate more carefully, as I've been saying. We should eliminate regulatory arbitrage and forum shopping. We must fund our regulatory agencies well and staff them adequately. We need to educate and inform consumers. It's dangerous to rely on caveat emptor in sophisticated financial markets. We need to avoid regulatory capture at all costs. And firms must be forced to respond promptly and accurately to regulators' requests for information. So what I'm saying is we need to be flexible. A strict one-size-fits-all regulatory mechanism is not necessarily a good thing. But this is international cooperation is going to be quite difficult. Mike Shearer of Harvard in 1994, who then was the world's leading industrial organisation economist, proposed that global mergers should be supervised by an international competition policy office. And this office would have had global investigative and enforcement responsibilities. Do you think the idea was well received? No. Went down like the proverbial lead balloon. 17 years later, it's still a pipe dream. Some people would still like it. One of my PhD students has just finished a very, very good thesis on this very topic. Despite the avalanche of cross-border mergers and all the problems they can cause, there is still no international body that regulates mergers. Now, some countries do talk to each other about this, but there's no systematic policy of international cooperation on this. Barry Eichengreen of Berkeley recently had similar thoughts to Shearer and wondered whether there could be a world finance organisation like the World Trade Organization. Membership of that would create certain obligations, and if you violated those obligations, there'd be certain serious consequences. Now, he hasn't gone into a great deal of detail on that, but that's something that is worth thinking about. But Shearer, you know, 17 years ago wanted a world merger authority. Whether we'll have a world finance organization might take another 17 years or more. So what we need then is good regulation. This is a plea for good regulation accompanied by good government intentions, good funding, and regulators who are on the ball. Effective regulation doesn't come cheaply, as I've said all along. We also need regulators to be careful, to be consultative in their oversight, appraisal, and enforcement. And of course, we shouldn't forget to polish our regulatory crystal ball every now and then. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for that, David.